Last episode, we discussed using your social media to grow your brand, and by the end of this episode, we are gonna reveal the pros and cons of running your own business. Welcome to Uncorked, where we bring you the latest trends and tips to win your market all while sipping fine wine. I'm your host, Reshia Guarnotta. Uncorked is a podcast show featuring fun and interesting conversations all about business, branding, and marketing trends. In each episode, I interview people who have done some highly notable things in their market, and they end up telling us their secrets to success as we drink some really good wine. Welcome to Uncorked. This is episode 13, and I have the honor of introducing you to my producer. He runs a thriving media company called Dylan Welch Media, and I'm also thrilled to have him on the show. Because today we're gonna reveal things that entrepreneurs don't really talk about. We are gonna talk about the pros of creating your own brand, yes, but we're actually gonna go into the details of some of the cons of growing a brand, creating a brand, and being an entrepreneur. So welcome to the show, Dylan Welch.
Thank you very much. Yeah. I appreciate it. It's always a pleasure. Fun fact, 13 is my lucky number.
Is it really?
So it's my birthday. So
okay,
and I didn't even put that together until you just said it right now.
Yeah.
So lucky episode 13.
Awesome.
Here we are.
Woo woo. Cheers to that. Yeah. Let's have a sip.
And thanks for the awesome intro.
Mm-hmm.
Not just surviving, but thriving. Right?
Yeah, exactly.
The life of the entrepreneur.
Yeah. So well, I feel like you took off really fast. I mean, it's like we met. For, you know, the first, like, hey, we should do the show. Everyone knows the backstory, but there's such a need for it.
Mm-hmm.
And so really you took a step out, and we'll get on into all of that. But I want to know, what are we drinking? You brought me a treat this time.
Yeah. You you always come with the big guns, the, you know, baller bottles. I got
baller
something
bottle.
A little bit more on the medium side. But what I noticed when I was purchasing this, it was top 15 powerful wine brands in 2018. So I was like, oh, branding, wine, it's kind of perfect for the show.
Yeah, and then you said powerful, like hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Cab's my favorite wine.
Same.
I've never been to Chile,
right.
But I've always wanted to.
Yeah.
So, and we've been drinking it and it tastes really good. So I'm happy with it.
Yeah.
You know, it's getting the job done, I'd say.
It is,
yeah. What do you think? What are your thoughts?
Well, when I opened it immediately, like it had a wonderful, wonderful, big, bold fragrance too. And so it was, I mean, immediately when I uncorked it. So that was cool. And then the color is great. It's dark. I always look for that because I like the bigger, bolder cabs. And some cabs that you pour, they're really light.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually love this. And
it's
the flavor is great too. It is smooth. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Goes down easy.
Yeah. And I normally would, I think that when you're looking for wine, so that was interesting that you kind of, you're not looking for a Napa Valley wine, right? Like you were just looking for something that caught your eye, and that was neat that they had this on their brand.
I mean, who knows if that's even true, but think
right.
about this. They said it, I was looking at their label. I didn't look at all at the quality of the wine. I was just like, ooh, branding, cool, buy it, take my money. And now here we are. So branding tip out there, think about that because it just works.
Yeah, and they say a lot with branding that you should say like some accolades and stuff like that. And this one really spoke to us just because of the whole, you know, powerful and everything that you said about it.
Yeah, no, as seen on, top blank, exclusive, all that stuff helps.
Yeah.
I try to pepper in all that into my marketing.
Exactly,
plan.
Yeah. You're like, how can we really, you know, get to the point here, sell the point here? So that's awesome. So for reference, you left your comfy, I guess, employee job or corporate job. And that really is that's really kind of like the cool thing to do right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like a lot of people don't really talk about the struggle and the journey. And so if we can just get into that. I mean, like what?
Totally.
Yeah,
I'll dive in. It's funny because, you know, there's so much information out there that some people, you know, there's blogs, there's memes, there's podcasts.
So much.
There's TV shows.
Yeah.
And everyone says so many different things, it's really hard to figure out what that is. So when I was at my job, I was doing research. I was like, oh, should I leave and start my own company? And half the people are saying, no, stick with it, save up, blah, 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 blah. If you leave, it's risky, blah, 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 blah. The other half—
Which it is.
Yeah, it is. So exactly.
Yeah.
And then the other half is like, go, do it, chase your dreams, blah, blah, blah. Like, get out there, you'll never, you know, all that stuff. So it's really hard to— It's kind of like the devil and angel on your shoulder, and you just have to figure out, you know, ultimately weigh the pros and cons of what is gonna, I think, is gonna make you most happy.
Yeah, that's key.
What's
gonna make you the most happy?
I think for business owners, it's not, obviously money is a huge driving factor because you need money to build a business, you need money to live. But also aside from that, I think a lot of business owners get a lot of value out of, you know, building something from scratch, pursuing something that they believe in, that they care about, building up their own baby. And when it came down to it, I did weigh all those pros and cons. I had a million conversations in my head. Yeah. Do I stay? Do I go? And I sat on it for a while, talked to probably everybody in my circle 20 times and probably annoyed them. But ultimately, just
you're obsessed about it, right? That's a good word to use.
Oh, I've totally been there. It is obsessive. Yeah. And then ultimately made the decision, and I've been happy with it. I mean, I think there's a lot of stressful parts that come with running a business, especially at the very beginning.
Right.
Getting it all up and running. There's, you know, initial funds you have to put into it to get it going. There's a lot of legal things you have to take care of. And that was a learning aspect for me because that's not something I'd necessarily done before on this level. Just because the company I want to grow, I want to make it as legitimate as possible.
Right.
So I'm going all those standard routes. So that was something I've learned. But now that I've done all that, it's also another tool I have under my belt that I know if I ever want to do this again, I know how to do it. So it's been a learning process. There's been struggles here and there, but ultimately I'm growing in ways that I never thought I could.
That's awesome.
And I don't want to talk about myself.
So I guess
if I could like pull a nugget of information for the viewer, identify what your goals are. What makes you the most happy? Is it a secure, comfortable job, or is it, are you a little bit more of a risk taker? There's so much information out there too that you just have to sift through the noise and find something that sticks with you and find a plan and go after it and get it. And then just every single day, you know, step by step, work on it, work on it, work on it. And I think similar to what you've done with this show is if you put yourself out there, people will respond to that.
I agree. And you're likable. And I think that that's what a lot of people...
That's also a huge factor.
You have to be likable, right?
Be extremely likable. Be awesome.
Be
get
nice.
Really lucky a lot.
Yeah, exactly.
Have really helpful friends that, you know, will connect you with potential clients. Yeah. That's also a big part of it, too.
It is. It is. It's all about relationships. So, okay, so for reference, like, I left my salary paid position in May of this year. And a lot of things that I'm seeing right now say, what is the greatest thing you did in 2019? And I'm like, quit my job. And I know that that sounds crazy. And it, it's been a struggle because it's so, the real estate market has been shifting a lot. It's been so weird. But then I've also, you know, now I'm into this podcast thing, and that would not have happened if I was still a manager. And then also kind of finding out like that I love coaching for brand story and brand clarity coaching and all that. Like it's all, it's created this more opportunity. And I realized I actually, the reason why my, you know, it wasn't a good fit for me, the reason why I left that job was they couldn't pay me enough to stay because I poured so much into it and it wasn't fulfilling because it wasn't a good fit for me. Like, and so when that happens, I think that that's when you're talking about like, really look at it. Is this part of your goals? Is this something that you want to do? If it's not fitting within what you want to do because you're not enjoying it and you come home stressed or pissed off every day, it's not going to be a good fit. Or you're in like a toxic environment, that's not going to be a good fit. So really evaluate that, right?
All right, let me ask you a question. Would you rather take a $1 million a year salary job that you hated or $100,000 that you loved?
Yeah.
And I know $100,000 is still actually a lot of money.
That is a lot of money. So absolutely, I would take $100,000 because I even said, like, I'll do this blank space of being salary for that number, slightly over $100,000.
Happiness is really important to you.
Yeah. For me, there are a lot of things I could do and I would make a lot more money. And I don't care.
Yeah.
Because
totally.
I have to be. And the other thing is I'm so obsessive about work. I mean, when I put my kids to sleep, like, of course, I love to spend time with them and stuff like that. But when my kids go to sleep, when my husband goes to sleep, my mind is still going. And I like to pour into my work. I like to think of new ideas and stuff like that. And so if I'm not passionate about what I'm doing, that's a huge element of my life that's missing. And I can't function like that.
Yeah.
You know, I like to create things.
Well, there's that really cliche. Yeah, I'll take some more. There's that cliche saying, oh, if you love what you're doing, it's not a day of work or whatever that is, which is definitely true. Yeah. I think no matter what industry you're in or your level of success or how much money you're making, there's always little stresses you'll have day to day.
Yeah.
But if you can appreciate, you know, what you're doing and you do find it fun to do, it does make life a lot better because it's not like, oh, I have to go do this. It's like, oh, cool, I get to go do this.
Yeah. You love, I love showing up today. We're doing, today we have a really special filming. We're doing two podcasts today. And one's
you can't give
group.
That away.
I'm just going to say that really quickly.
Okay.
No, that's all I'm going to say.
Next episode.
But what I'm saying is I've been pumped about it for a whole week. Mm-hmm. We've been planning this for longer, but I kind of play things week by week. And as we've been preparing for this week, there's been a lot of excitement around it.
Yeah,
a lot of preparing for it.
So what would you say is your top pro and your top con of running your business?
The top pro and top con. Okay. Well, the pro is that it doesn't matter how much, I have the full flexibility to do whatever I want to do with it. Mm-hmm. It's totally up to me, which can also be a con. Uh-huh. And then a con would be that, I guess in the beginning, it was really isolating. Mm-hmm. And so you really have to kind of find a way to not be isolated, to really
true.
Find that pack, that culture, and really be around those people that uplift you. And I think that just from this, you've become a part of one of the key players in my life, in my business. I'm able to, recommend you to so many people because I just like being around you. Mm-hmm. And so when you find those key people that you love being around that help you grow your business because you're able to collaborate together, I think that that's a good, mm-hmm. that's a good win.
Oh, totally. Yeah. And no, it's true because you start to attract other people who are like-minded, right? And a mm-hmm. lot of my clients are like this, you being one of them, but I'll get texts, and I'll text you at 2 a.m.
I know,
like,
it's awesome.
I just had this awesome idea.
I love it.
And I'll get those too. And if I hated what I was doing, I'd be like, why are you texting me at 2 a.m.? Instead, I'm like, oh my God, I was just thinking this too, you know? And it's cool. And going back to what we were talking about before, I don't mind doing that stuff because it's fun and exciting.
Yeah, you're actually amped about it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And your con, it can be kind of lonely because you're kind of, especially when you leave a company, it's like breaking up with
It's devastating.
A significant other or something where it's like, it's not you, it's me. Mm-hmm. I have to go pursue other things and you have to cut them out of your life.
And it's
sometimes
weird.
You miss them.
Yeah.
And you're like, I just want to text
you.
No, yeah.
Yeah, I still miss people that I worked with. I mean, it was a huge part of my life. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was around those people every single day.
Yeah.
And so there's people that we, when you talk to them every day, and then they're not there anymore. It's good to check in and stuff like that.
No, it's funny because I had friends at my old job after I left and they'd send me memes and stuff.
Yeah.
I'm like, we miss you.
It's I like what I'm doing now.
But also at the same time, when you think about it in a relationship way, sometimes you have to cut out a toxic significant other so that you can separate yourself and find somebody new. And I think that's kind of how I've been looking at it. It's like, okay, one door closes. Another door opens.
Exactly. And sometimes you do have to close that door in order to open up another. Now, there's still responsibility in that. I think that a lot of people that, they want to be entrepreneurs, but maybe they're not designed to be one. And so really looking at that and going is this for me? Because it is hard. I mean, let's jump into the cons of entrepreneurship, of starting your own brand. It's kind of I'd say the biggest thing is that you are everything. So it's like, here's your brand and you revolve around it all unless you're willing to pay for other people to do it for you. And then it becomes expensive. There's a lot of fees that are involved. Mm-hmm. What has that journey been like for you with filling in the space and learning things?
Entrepreneurialism or entrepreneurship, whatever that word is definitely a glorified thing.
It totally
especially
is
especially
right now,
with social media.
Yeah.
They're especially
entrepreneur, what's the other one? Public figure. I don't know.
Exactly. And especially with social media because you want to post your wins.
Yeah.
And then the algorithms of social media show you the stuff you're interested in. So my social media feed is people with Ferraris, Lamborghinis, helicopters. And that's not how it is, honestly.
Yeah.
I think one of the biggest things
is not.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, sure, I'll be taking off in my helicopter after this, but not everyone gets to live that life. No, I'm just kidding. I think the most important thing.
You're not allowed to.
Yeah. No, the most important thing is you have to actually sell a product and get revenue if you want to live or not live, but run a business. Like right. there's a whole...
It has to make sense.
Yeah, there's like that's something that people really don't understand is, oh, they've got the marketing, they've got the branding, they've got 100,000 followers.
Yeah, but, they're flexing online. Like, yeah, ugh, gosh.
But are you actually generating revenue?
Right.
Are you actually selling a product? Is your product innovative in any way?
Yeah.
And that's something I think not a lot of people realize. And that's why you'll see on the news someone has 3 million followers and they couldn't sell 10 t-shirts, you know?
Yeah.
You have to start, and that's the hardest part. Like that's, you know, living in America is in a capitalist society.
Mm-hmm.
It's a dog race. Everyone's trying to, you know, beat the other person.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
You have to be really innovative with what your product is, what your mm-hmm. service is. Otherwise, you know, if someone wants to buy it, they'll go find someone else. And some people just don't have a product at all. They're like, I have 1 million followers, give me money. It's yeah. like, no, you have to provide some
that
sort of value.
That would be great. I would
society.
Love that if someone just like, just give me wine and I'll talk
I'm
about
sure
it.
I'm sure there are a lot of people who are just get that. I'm not there yeah. yet. I don't want to
yeah,
be.
Yeah, I don't know if that Maybe would be I like do, your thing. Yeah. I think that you're really, you're in your space and then you have mm-hmm. some other things that I'm not going to go into that you'll reveal yeah. someday that you're working on. That's like super exciting.
Yeah. So the to pull the value from that or yeah. the nugget or whatever is if you're thinking about starting a business, start with a product. Identify what you can actually
that's
sell
good.
That someone would actually yeah. buy
mm-hmm.
that's different from everybody else and build off of that. Like
yeah.
that's everyone looks at the branding, the marketing. Start with the product
right.
and then find people to buy that product and
right.
go out and sell it. And then once you have revenue coming in, use that money for all the other stuff.
Mm-hmm. That's good. And then when you have that product, identify. So a lot of people will be like, who's your client or who's mm-hmm. your listener with podcasting?
Yeah.
And when I started the podcast, that was a question I got all the time was like, who's your listener? And I'm like, everybody that drinks wine or runs a business. But it was very unclear in the beginning. And mm-hmm. I think that's a question that a lot of people try and answer when they're creating a product or a service or an experience, whatever mm-hmm. it may be. And you actually have to reverse engineer it. You actually have to look at it as like, mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm going to figure out who my client is. Before I do that, I need to figure out what my brand solves.
Mm-hmm.
So
exactly.
Your brand, I would say, if we're just talking about your media company, if there are the people that are not able to produce their podcast or not able to get in front of people, like mm-hmm. that's where they would, I mean, those are the people that you're talking to and that's mm-hmm. how you identify it is first
exactly.
by starting with the problem.
Yeah. And yeah. I mean, even with my company, it started out as something different and that's another just good thing to think about
oh,
too is
cool.
be flexible
yeah.
with what you're doing too. Identify trends that are happening
mm-hmm.
and try to maneuver them so that the product you're offering is ahead of that trend. So when everybody wants to do it, you have it right there kind of
right.
dangling out. That's kind of what when I started, I had a few different products and services and they've changed, they've molded. I've combined a few, I've
yeah.
taken a couple away to offer basically this like all-inclusive thing.
Yeah.
And then now, especially the people like you who are business owners, they're super media branding, marketing savvy. It's like, oh my God, that has everything that I would need
yeah.
to go do all the stuff I want to do.
Right.
So that's another nugget of information.
You
if
developed
you will.
It. So it's like
yeah.
you start out with a concept.
Mm-hmm.
So let's back up. So you start okay. off with a concept and I've done the same thing, but I just want to make it really clear, really black and white concept. And then sometimes it's like not even what you come up with is the thing that you're ending up with. Allow it to develop is what
mm-hmm.
you're saying.
Yeah.
So you have your concept and then you're really watching your market and seeing what it is that they need. And then you realize, okay, this is where I can fulfill this void. Like this client is gonna need this here because I mean, they ask for it.
Mm-hmm.
So when you start building your client database, your customer database, and then they end up telling you what it is that they
yeah.
need.
Seriously,
yeah.
I've added on my website right now, I started with a few different services and then mm-hmm. someone will be like, oh, can you help me do this? And I'm like, yeah, I can do that. And then I just added it as an add-on service for
yeah.
everyone else because it's, you just give people what they want.
Right.
Especially if you have that clientele or
yeah.
that email list or you already have it working, you can kind of add on.
That's
and that's what's cool about if you are starting to generate revenue, you are starting to work with people, you can add on to that.
Right.
That's really where it gets exciting.
Yeah. Now, there is a one con that it could be a pro or a con. So
uh-huh.
entrepreneurs are very, I guess, like, is it positive thinkers? I can't even think of the word right now because it's wine. But when you're an entrepreneur,
like
you're
optimistic.
Like, there is no way I could ever fail. And that can be a pro, But then it can also be a con, mm-hmm. because when you're thinking about it, like, you're not looking at it subjectively. Like, you're like, oh, there's no way this is going to fail. Mm-hmm. And so do you have anything to say about that? I mean, like, how's that experience been for you? Have you been learning the hard way with that? Or
it's tough. I mean, I definitely take a lot of, especially when I first started, I took a lot of stuff personal.
Yeah. I'm so guilty of that.
One thing that I've gotten really used to, and I kind of laugh it off now, is like getting rejected. Yeah. I'll throw out so many different ideas, different people, and sometimes they'll be like, oh yeah, I'll think about it. Other times I'll be like, no, that's stupid. Don't ever talk to me again.
Oh.
And honestly, that's just part of like, it's just me putting out feelers.
Yeah,
you know?
But it is subjective. Like it's up to them. I mean, it's like, they're not gonna like, that's why there's so many different cars, wines, everything out on the market, because everybody has different tastes.
And that's what I realize is what I do isn't for everybody, and there's nothing wrong with that. And it's kind of cool, actually. I like finding the people who really get it and then taking off and running with them.
And those are the people that you really want to surround yourself with anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
So it doesn't really...
Like, screw everybody else.
Like, no,
like, you don't like what I want.
Think about it.
No,
if they're like, I don't want to be in front of a camera, you're like, then we're probably not a good fit, because what are you going to talk with them about? Like, how are you guys going to collaborate? Yeah. Like, everything.
What was the question again? Then, I feel like I totally went off on a different
route. We actually just talked about it. Yeah, you're good.
Sure.
So, and then the other obvious thing, I don't even think we need to talk about, really, but you obviously don't get a salary. So, that's been the definite shift, is when you're going from a salary and you're going, all of my, you know, expenses are based on this, you know, income, and then that changes, and then setting your value. So, I mean, really the words of encouragement, I've had to listen to podcasts and everything about, you know, how do you set your own value? Because it can be, I mean, it's hard to, hard to do that.
Yeah.
That's one of the biggest things that, I mean, especially women, I don't know if men struggle with it, but women entrepreneurs, like, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but we really struggle with really setting our value.
I think, and I am a huge victim of doing this, especially when you're first starting a business up and running, you just want to get what
you
can get.
And you want to give. I think that you have a very giving spirit, so do I. And it's like, I can't give partially.
Exactly.
Like, you only paid for this, but I just want to give you everything because I love you.
Exactly. That's something that I've kind of started to put my foot down, and, you know, I've had a lot of people, I'll explain what I do and then I'll tell them the price and they're like, wow, you could be charging like 10 times that much.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, you know, I get that. I also want to provide.
Just kidding. It's actually more.
Yeah. Actually, it's 100%
more. It's 100% more than what I
used to listen to this.
Yeah.
But that's, I've learned a lot about basically just, you know, perceived value within myself. It's added a lot of self-confidence for me when I tell someone the price of something and they're like, you should charge more and I would pay more than that. And it's like, okay, cool. Well, that means the service that I'm providing adds a lot of value. And a lot of times you can't just put a numeric monetary value on the stuff. Yeah. So it's your individual expertise that you bring to the table that's either worth $1 an hour or $1 million an hour.
Right.
And then you have to figure out where that is and then stick with it too. Honestly, like it set, and that's kind of what I've done, is I've set it in stone and now I'm not really budging from it.
Yeah.
And
well, you don't need to now. I mean, in the beginning, it's like maybe adjust a little bit for your friends, kind of build your, I mean, what I did in the beginning for the actual coaching business is I have a couple clients that I started off with that I helped, they helped me build the program. So they got a huge discount. And then now as it's all built, and they understood that, they're like, we're part of this whole program of us building. And now that it's built. And that's what it is. That's a set price. But really surrounding yourself, I'd say like the biggest takeaway for people would be to surround yourself with people that get it. Because if you're around people that are, like that don't think that you're going to be able to accomplish what you're, you know, wanting to do, they're just going to bring you down. And so you really need those key
colleagues. Those people out of your life.
Yeah, I know, right? Like you need people to send you that text message that says value yourself.
And that, exactly. And that's something we kind of talked about. And I think going back to what you're mentioning about, you know, salary and paying yourself, one thing that, you know, I'm proud about is I've got an awesome staff who are behind the camera over there who are helping me with everything. And for me, you know, I don't want to pinch every penny I can out of my business. I would rather reinvest the money that is being generated into bringing on more people or adding on something mm-hmm. or just making it overall better, whether it's investing in a new website mm-hmm. or getting better gear or bringing on another person who can add another service. Like I just brought on a social media person
to
my team.
I know, that's awesome. So good.
Which it's an investment to bring her on, but yeah. now I can add more services to my current clients, to my new clients. So that's something I've noticed with other businesses that I've worked with is they're always looking at the bottom line. And yeah. it's like, oh, we turned X amount of profit last month and we turned X amount this month. When if they spent a little more, a year later, they would have expanded to who knows.
Right.
So that's something I always recommend as a business owner, as a person mm-hmm. in general, is invest in yourself.
Yep.
Like, that's the most valuable thing you can ever do,
right.
in my opinion.
And it shows, and it also helps create the culture. So when you're just looking at the bottom line, that's not longevity. That's it's mm-hmm. over really quick.
Yeah.
I agree with that. Gosh, we talked about a lot. Do we have any like words, our last like growing a brand, last thing we want to say? I mean, last words of advice.
What would Carolina Wine say? Just be powerful.
Be powerful,
just
yeah.
automatically be in the top 15 yeah. brands in your industry.
Yep. And you know how you do that? Is you, what we said, surround yourself with awesome people. Mm-hmm. You consume very good content every single day. So
educate
subscribe
yourself.
And like this show.
Yep,
so
you like this. Subscribe.
But podcast.
Somewhere around
Gary
here,
V.
There's a button.
Gary V. There's you know, he's yeah. he's a great one to listen to.
Invest in yourself.
Invest in yourself. Yep.
Learn, educate, surround yourself yep. with good people.
Get a coach. If you don't have
Cut
good people around you.
People. Actually,
get a
here's
coach.
A question for you.
Yeah.
How do you find good mentors? Because that's yeah. something that I struggle with.
Really?
Yeah.
So I don't, I've had the same mentor since I was, believe it or not, 12. Mm-hmm. And as I know that sounds crazy, she's not a relative or anything, but she is actually a life coach and she's uh-huh. just kind of built into that. And then I gravitate towards people that, and I don't want to say gravitate. I put myself in situations where I'm around really great people. So, I just posted something on Instagram that I had gone to a Compass party, and that's like I'm surrounded by people that I look up to, but I chose to be in that room. Mm-hmm. Like I chose to go to that party. I chose to be a part of that company. And so really, because those people elevate my business, because when I'm talking to them and going, hey, what have you seen in this market? How are you dealing with this? And they're giving me words of encouragement and they're telling me how they got through it or what they're doing to stand out also. Mm-hmm. And then I'm, you know, returning the favor. Like it's like a collaboration. Mm-hmm. So that's how.
All right. So what do you do to find a good mentor?
Really? I think it's a personality fit. Mm-hmm. And so there are people that you're going to gravitate towards or people that you're going to want to surround yourself with and anyone that you're drawn to. So, you know, that whole gut feeling when you meet someone and you're like, this person's not a good fit for me.
Yeah.
That's probably true. Mm-hmm. But when you meet someone that you want to be like and that you look up to, those are the people that you should be surrounding yourself mm-hmm. with. Like,
okay.
Make yourself go to those networking events that are with the people like that. Mm-hmm. You know, surround yourself with those people.
Yeah.
That's what I think. All right, what's your favorite drink? I never asked you that.
My favorite alcoholic drink?
Yes.
Okay, so I don't know if you knew this. I probably told you this. Right out of college, I lived in Italy for
yeah.
2 years in Florence, which is like the hub of red wine.
Okay.
Being 22 years old, all we did was drink red wine
right.
like every single night. So I got really sick of it.
Oh.
I didn't drink red
Aww.
Wine for a while. And then kind of serendipitously, if that's the right word, like
yeah.
my girlfriend started getting me into it.
Yeah.
We started filming this show. And now I'm
like
obsessed with
it.
Red wine again. So I'd say right now, probably some cab, some Chianti.
Yes, yes.
If you asked me like a year ago, it probably would have been White Claws or vodka sodas.
Yeah,
but you know,
no.
I'm trying to refine my taste.
Yes,
a
well, especially because I bring you wine, where I'm like, Dylan, you have to try this.
Yeah.
It's like a $200 bottle,
I've
and you're
a lot.
Like, okay.
Yeah, exactly.
I definitely want you to be spoiled. Like, I want you to be like, oh, that wine, I don't know, but this one's good. You did a good job.
Yeah, I think
so.
It's, good job, Carolina.
Yeah, good job.
Do yo thing. Was this a funny episode, would you say?
Funny. I think this was probably one of the most informative
yes.
episodes because
okay.
you and I just like hunkered down and we're like, let's just give as much value as we can.
Can I wrap this up on a little story? That
yeah,
this is
absolutely.
The highlight of my 2019.
Yeah.
Went to Thanksgiving with my girlfriend's parents. Mm-hmm. And a couple days later, her mom texts her, wow, Dylan's really funny. And I was like, yes.
That's all you wanted?
That made my year. I was like, I'm the funny guy. So if you need any jokes, let me know. Especially after Jason's last episode, I listened. I was like, man, this is freaking hilarious.
I was laughing out loud. I had my earbuds on.
I wanted to come and bring some jokes. So
maybe.
Hopefully I made you laugh. Yeah. If not, hopefully you got some valuable content.
I love it. Yeah. Well, hey, let's cheers to that.
Cheers.
Thanks, Dylan.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Thanks for listening. Be sure to tune in next week. And remember to hit the subscribe button on your favorite platform. Reviews really help us out. And remember to share the show if you got some serious value out of us today. If you are interested in exploring anything we talked about, visit uncorkshow.com.